About 5 years ago, I gave a sermon titled The Organizing Principle. You may or may not remember it. I wanted to look at the organization of the first Christians. What was it that directed, organized? How did they go about doing stuff that they did? Usually, once I give a sermon, I erase the memory banks, and it goes in a book, in a box, and put on a shelf, and I never think about it again. I came to some conclusions at the time, but some of the themes of this weekend have led me to open that box again and see what it might have been. What I was going to talk about up there had to do with a lot of what they were developing having to do with the development of churches, how they would go, how they'd be organized, how they would handle their business. So I thought, well, let's open the box again and see what I had to say at the time. First of all, what does the term organizing principle mean? Here's a definition. An organizing principle is a core assumption from which everything else by proximity derives a classification or value. It is like a central reference point that allows all other objects to be located. Having an organizing principle might help one simplify and get a handle on a very complicated domain. But, the definition went on the other hand, it might create a deceptive prism that colors one's judgment. And it was that line that really made me stop and think. Not many of you are old enough, a couple of you here are, and I don't think very many of you out there watching are, old enough to, or were in the right place, I should say, to appreciate what the Radio Church of God was like in the 1930s. Some of you may never have even heard of the Radio Church of God, in the 1940s, I said. It was, I think, a lot more like the churches that we're used to in our tradition today, in what is oftentimes called the independent church movement. Certainly more like that than it was like the Worldwide Church of God of the late 50s. It was, in a word, a free and open church. Anyone was welcome to attend. You could walk right in off the street and sit down, enjoy the services with everybody else, or not. Baptism was a simple matter. You merely had to be repentant and to accept Christ as your Savior. You got under the water and you're baptized. There was, in those early years, a surprising variety of faith and practice. For example, some women wore makeup and some women did not. And to some degree, they went on like that for quite some time, from the time that part of the church was organized and began to develop until finally that ruling was changed. There they were. So that was one of the interesting things that existed. I don't know the events that led to the change that took place, but about 1952, Dick Armstrong wrote an article for the Good News magazine titled, Did Christ Put Authority and Rule in His Church? Now, you can probably figure out real quick the answer to that was, yes, He most certainly did. I'm going on memory here. I couldn't find the precise title, and I no longer have a copy of the article, but anyway, in the interest of maintaining unity, this was the thing that they were aiming at, some fundamental changes took place. A ruling was handed down, which is where the authority and rule came from, or was necessary for, that women could no longer wear makeup. You could not attend church without being invited. That if you actually went out on a minister, went on a visit and visiting you in your living room, he had to come to the conclusion that you were pretty close to baptism, or he wouldn't invite you to church. If you still had some rather large questions, if you were still working on the Sabbath and thinking about it, couldn't come to church. Governance in the church was top down. So from that time forward, the organizing principle of that church had changed. From then on, the organizing principle was government, authority, and top down rule in the church. Anyone who was around is quite familiar with what that looked like. The principle allowed the church to grow, to change its name properly to Worldwide, to build three colleges, and to do a significant work. But it also created a prism that covered everything, colored everything we did, everything we saw, and even what we thought. And I'm going to make a statement here that's going to sound strange to some people, but I'm prepared to argue the case if I need to. It actually inhibited the growth of the church. It ultimately led to the closure of three colleges and the church's eventual collapse and the scattering of sheep to the four winds that we have seen in more recent years. Speaking for myself, I viewed everything through that prism up until 1978 when I resigned from the church. I don't ask you to see things as I saw them, but to realize that for me, an internal revolution followed that resignation and the cessation of looking at everything through the same prism that I had looked at it through for so many years. Once I stopped looking through that prism, everything changed. For me, it was like turning on a light in a dark room, as I described it at the time. Things suddenly became a lot clearer. Ideas, concepts, and things came rushing at me that were inescapable, but I never saw them before because I was looking at everything through the prism, the organizing principle of the church. Now, my earlier sermon on the organizing principle focused on the church of the first Christians. I concluded then that the organizing principle of the church was the Holy Spirit. But their world was really very different from ours. I don't doubt that the Holy Spirit is just as available today as it was then. We may not be so finely attuned to it as they were, because the reason I felt that Luke described the working of the Holy Spirit and that it stopped them from going into Bithynia, forbade them to preach the gospel in Asia, all I could conclude from that, how they knew that, was they were looking for it. They expected the Holy Spirit to lead, and when something happened, they figured where it came from. So anyway, in a strange way, I may have described the directing force of the early church, but I had missed an important, vital element in the organizing principle of the first Christians. Okay? Look at it this way. Where and how is the leadership of the Holy Spirit applied? Where does it interface with the church? In the authoritarian model, the leadership is applied only to those in authority. In other words, the leadership of the Holy Spirit is applied to the church from the top down. This, how the Spirit leads you personally may not be as important as how it leads the apostle. You know, the one that's in charge. That's one of the things. Now, I want to demonstrate how the Holy Spirit worked in one very important New Testament example. It's in Acts chapter 13, for your reference. Now, there's an interesting thing about the book, The Church in Antioch, where this begins to take place. It was not exactly the result of a missionary effort of one of the apostles coming out from Jerusalem and going up there and doing the work and building a church and what have you. What actually happened is some Jews wound up, you know, for, I think they were Cypriot Jews, wound up in Antioch, and they began to preach to the God-fearers in Antioch, and around them formed the Antioch church. As far as I can see, without any governing ties to Jerusalem, none had been spoken of up until this point. Now, there were in the church that was in Antioch certain prophets and teachers: Barnabas, Simeon called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Menaean, who had actually been brought up with Herod, and Saul. We know Saul, don't we? Later called Paul. And as they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Spirit said, "Separate me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work whereunto I have called them." Now, Luke doesn't explain something we would very much like to know. How exactly did that happen? Whose ear did the Holy Spirit whisper into? I mean, how did this become clear to them that it was not just a generalized idea of the leadership, but that the Holy Spirit said, "Do this"? Well, we tend to look at the Holy Spirit as something like the Force in Star Wars. You know, it's there, it's a power and all that, but doesn't talk to people. It didn't merely influence. In this case, though, Luke said it said something. And the something was quite specific. Now, if there was an authority in the example, the authority was the Holy Spirit, wasn't it? Where else are you going to look for it? It wasn't the pastor of the Antioch church. If there was one, he isn't mentioned anywhere in the Bible. Did you ever notice that? That man is never named, if there was such a thing in Antioch. Now, later on, there was a bishop in Antioch. We find his letter showing up in Nicene Fathers literature. But he's not in the Bible, mentioned anywhere at all. And when they had fasted and prayed, they laid their hands on them and sent them away. And so they, being sent forth by the Holy Spirit, departed into Seleucia, from whence they sailed off to Cyprus. Now forgive me, but there is an elephant in the room that nobody notices. It lies in what was not done. What did they not do? Well, this was also not present in the conversion of Saul. Remember him? He's on the road to Damascus. He gets knocked down on the road to Damascus. Didn't get knocked down in Jerusalem. He got knocked down the road to Damascus, proceeded on to Damascus, and his whole conversion process took place up there. His call, his baptism, his commissioning, his development of his arguments that he would use for many, many years after, all took place in Damascus, of all places. What was missing? It was this. No one thought of consulting the apostles in Jerusalem about whether they should do this or not. There was no consultation. They didn't ask. The Holy Spirit said, send them out. They sent them out. I presume the way it's worded that the Antioch church endowed this particular mission. They actually provided the funds. They sent them out. They stood behind them and gave them everything they needed on this. There was no higher authority, but of course, how could there be a higher authority than the Holy Spirit in making this kind of decision? So once that commission had been given, once Paul was commissioned in Damascus, no one asked anybody in Jerusalem for approval, nor was any approval given, talked about, suggested, or anything else. Now you see what I'm driving at about the Holy Spirit being the organizing principle in all this? Now, there was, in a way, it is the empowerment, but there was still another organizing principle that made this possible. Now, how do I explain this? To me, one of the most fascinating illustrations of this principle appeared first in the Garden of Eden. I feel myself, in my old age, getting around to where I keep going back to Genesis 1:1. There must be something in that as you get older that makes you go back there more and more. But this principle is so important, it bears going back to, and maybe that's why some preachers do it so often. Because the foundation stones for so much, right there, Genesis 1, 2, 3, 4, because this is where we learn about God first. You know the story, you may have heard me on this before. God planted a garden eastward in Eden. Note, the garden wasn't Eden, it was eastward in Eden. It wasn't the whole world, it was just part of that world at that time. In that garden, he placed Adam and Eve. He put in there every kind of tree and fruit. He told Adam and Eve to be fruitful and multiply, and then he went away and he left them alone. I don't know what people think about God. I really don't sometimes. I think they must see him as a voyeur, that he is watching them in their bedroom just like he must have watched Adam and Eve in the garden. Whatever they were going to do to be fruitful and multiply, he would see it. And yet, when he comes back into the garden later on, he comes wandering into the place and says, Adam, where are you? You mean he didn't know? He could have known, but he chose not to. He could have watched. He chose not to. He chose not to know what they had done. This, to me, is one of the most stunning, basic principles in the Bible, and it's right there from the start if anybody will pay any attention to it. Here it is. There is a huge problem in all this that stares theologians in the face, and it is the presence of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil in the garden. It was there, and they were told not to eat of it, right? So what's important about that? Well, in the answer to my question, here is this simple truth. If God didn't want them to eat of that tree, why did he put it there? This, to me, is huge and almost completely overlooked by so many, whole lines of theology, whole churches are based on premises that do not consider and do not really answer this question. The tree was available. They had instructions. they were free to disobey those instructions. Now, for all those who want to make God over in their own image, this is an insurmountable problem. You can't get over it. You can't get there from here. Adam and Eve could have been prevented from making this mistake by the simple expediency of not putting the tree there in the first place. Bang, we got the problem is solved. But unless they were free to make a choice like this, they were not free at all. So in the, you remember the TV series Star Trek? If you're a Trekkie, you will know what I mean when I speak of the Prime Directive. There was a Prime Directive that all those starships going out in different quadrants of the universe were required to follow. They could not interfere in the history, the evolution of a society, the development of a peoples. They were sent out to observe, to learn, to find out what was there, to encounter every kind of life form, but they couldn't change anything out there. That's the Prime Directive. They could not interfere with the freedom of those people to develop whatever way the people themselves chose to develop. Important concept. Now, I'm going to tell you today what God's Prime Directive was then and still is. The word, and it is a word, is freedom. That is the Prime Directive. We know all about the Ten Commandments, right? There is an organizing principle that is even more important to our understanding than the Ten Commandments. Actually, it's not an 11th commandment. It's an uber commandment for leaders. Here it is, quote, "Thou shalt do nothing to abridge the freedom of man," end quote. To all of us who lead, to all of us who are in charge of churches, to all of us who are pastors, whatever it is we're doing to teach, whatever it is to God's people, here's our first number one guiding principle. You shall do nothing to abridge the freedom of God, freedom of man. I don't want to be repetitious, but there is one classic example that flies in the face of the old organizing principle that we followed for so many years. You know, in the years that after the conquest of Canaan, that the land was divided by lot, and each of the tribes had their part of the land that they were supposed to inherit. There were elders in each of those tribes. There were family relationships that worked between them. Do you ever realize that in those years there was no uber government, there was no governmental structure above the local elder of that tribe of people? Oh, there was the priesthood, of course, at the tabernacle. That the priesthood was there to serve God. It was there to take their offerings, offer them to God, to carry out the ritual of the temple, to conduct the holy days, and then send the people back home where they lived their own way. Now, there were laws. There were laws that controlled what happened if you killed a man, as to whether it was self-defense or whether it was not. There were cities of refuge, a place where you could flee, and where due process of law could be carried out. The principle of due process of law goes clean back to Moses. Probably even a little earlier than that, but that's where we learn of it first of all. Don't know if it was in Hammurabi's code or not. But nevertheless, they were there. Freedom, they learned down through those years of the judges, has its burdens. That if they forgot God, if they broke down or didn't maintain the hedge that God had put around them in the first place, here came the Philistines, or various and sundry other neighboring tribes, plundered them, killed them, carried off their daughters, and they had to gird their loins and fight, saddle up and go out and get your sword, fight the enemy, and recover. And they suffered a lot of losses during those years. Freedom, you see, has its burdens, and sometimes men decide they're weary, they're tired, they just want to lay the burdens down. They want someone else to carry them for them. And that's one thing God wants us to learn. Don't expect Him to carry all those burdens for you. He will guide you. He will direct you. He will give you freedom, but He may require you to fight for it. He may require you to face death for it. So, you know, the Scripture says, roll your burden on the Lord. Absolutely. Take your burdens to Him in prayer, but don't assume that He's going to carry all your problems for you, open every door for you, close every door that you shouldn't go through. The reason He won't do that is because, and it's front to back in the Bible. I'm sorry. You can throw me proof texts that you think do say something else, but fundamental is you have to decide. You have to struggle. You have to fight. You have to overcome. That's a part of the freedom that God bestowed. Now, after one too many wars and too much corruption in government, the people came to Samuel. 1 Samuel 8, verse 1. It came to pass when Samuel was old, he made his sons judges over Israel. The name of his firstborn was Joel. The name of his second, Abiah. And they deserve to have their names written down here. They were judges in Beersheba. His sons walked not in his ways, but turned aside after money and took bribes and perverted judgment. Nothing ever changes, does it? Power is accumulated centrally. People try to bribe their way through that power. Corruption enters. Now, what was the thing to do at this point? You're an elder in Manasseh or Ephraim, and you come rolling down to Samuel, and you say, "What in the world are you letting those boys do this for?" What do you do? What do you require? What do you say? Well, here's what they did. All the elders gathered themselves together and came to Samuel in Ramah and said, "Look, you're old." "Well, thanks a lot. Your sons walk not in your ways. Now make us a king to judge us like all the nations." Now, you don't have to be brilliant to think about the fact that there were alternatives to that. They could have demanded of Samuel that he put his boys out of the priesthood. Were there no men in his family? Were there no men in Levi? Couldn't you find some son of Aaron somewhere to do this job? Of course he could. And the fact that he dismissed his sons from that job, punished them for what they had done, might have served as a warning to the next guy that took the job. But they didn't do that. That's not what they said. They said, "We want a king." They actually came to him and asked for top-down rule and authority. And you have to kind of wonder, it might be worth it for you to take a little time sometime to just sit and stare off into space with a cup of coffee or something and think that through. What in the world would cause a person to want top-down authority? Well, you know, it takes certain responsibility for decisions away from you. You don't have to make decisions. You just have to do as you're told. You don't have to think things through. Thinking can be painful. I could go on with a number of things, but just think it through for yourself. Now, this, by the way, was based on a lot more than a couple of corrupt priests. That was a problem that could have been handled easily enough. Reject the service of the priests, walk away, and don't use them at all, and don't give them any offerings at all. And they would have solved that problem probably themselves without Samuel having to do anything initially. They could have gone to Samuel and says, "We're not going to tolerate these boys any longer." What was Samuel supposed to do at that point in time? Beat him about the head and shoulders? I don't think so. I think if they'd come down and given him an ultimatum to get rid of those two boys, they'd have been gone by sundown. But the thing displeased Samuel when they said, "Give us a king to judge us," because he knew what was at stake here. And he prayed to the Lord, and the Lord said to Samuel, this is one of the more important verses in the Bible. You remember this now. God told Samuel, "Listen to the voice of the people in all that they say to you. They have not rejected you, they have rejected me, that I should not reign over them." Do you realize that governance of Israel up until this time was a true theocracy? People worry about a theocracy being an authoritarian top-down government. It's not. They were the freest that any human beings have ever been in all their history, the people during the time of the judges. That they messed it up doesn't say anything bad about God, only about them. There was never a freer people than these under God. But they were tired, they were lazy, they were afraid. And God went on to Samuel. He said, "All the works they have done since the day I brought them up out of Egypt to this day, wherewith they have forsaken me, served other gods, so do they to you. Now, therefore, listen to their voice, but protest to them solemnly and show them the manner of the king that shall reign over them." Now, you take a little time and read through what God told Samuel to tell them the king would be like and how their government was going to go now that they're making this change. And you will find it's astonishingly close to precisely the civilization that we live in right now. The only reason it isn't any closer is because so far we haven't made these final steps into the giving up of freedom. Now, this is pretty clear. Thanks to television, we can see things that our fathers back when never could. But did you notice the elephant that walked into the room here again. God specifically yielded to their request. Why on earth did he do that? I was wondering that myself when I was doing something not long ago, I was teaching something, and I came to this particular illustration. I think it was the program, How Freedom is Lost. I listened to this, and I said, do you know why he did this? Because God was totally freedom, I mean, oriented to and committed to the freedom of his man. Thou shalt do nothing to abridge the freedom of man. Coercive authority, you know, sending a plague among the people. Samuel could have said to them, go home. And then a plague broke out among them. This is not unprecedented among people who have dealt with God. The problem is that there may be a time when you're in the desert and on the march across the promised land when severe discipline might be required. But sooner or later, and your objective is to get to the place to where every man is free. God was committed to that, and anything other than allowing them that freedom would have denied it, would have denied what he was wanting to do. If you aren't free to reject God's governance, you're not free. If you aren't free to do stupid, harmful things, you're not free. If you aren't free to suffer the consequences of the stupid, harmful things you do, you are not free. If you're not free to commit sin, you're not free. If you're not free to hurt others, you're not free. If you're not free to be hurt by others, you're not free. Many of the things that puzzle us about God are answered by this simple organizing principle, freedom, and God's total commitment to the freedom of man. That was the thing I came to realize when I was doing that program. The reason God made this decision was his total commitment to the freedom of his people. He wanted them to make the choices to serve him as their own choices, not as something that was forced on them. Because coerced love is not love at all. Now here we are living at a pivotal point in history. We are closing out an era in our society where we have enjoyed maximum freedom. And look what we were able to do during those years of our freedom. But we live in a society that is tired, effete, and is just frankly becoming unwilling to carry the burden that comes along with freedom. And they're wanting more top-down authority. They're wanting the government to do things for them. They're wanting the government to pay their bills, fight their battles, do the whole things. The only thing I don't think the children of Israel ever really understood, they said, give us a king to fight our battles for us. Did they think he was going out there by himself? All alone? No. Basically, what Samuel said, he will institute a draft, which they did. Now, there is an odd illustration before us every day of our lives. I want you to think about it, you know, from this day forward. The news media are playing the role of the false prophets in the time of the kings. Example, 1 Kings chapter 22. They continued 3 years without war between Syria and Israel, which I gather was as much a miracle then as it is today. But we had a saying in the Navy about people who just couldn't leave well enough alone. We said, some people just can't stand prosperity. And that seems to have been a factor here. In the third year, Jehoshaphat, the king of Judah, went down to see the king of Israel, went on a state visit. And the king of Israel had said to his officials, don't you know that Ramoth-Gilead belongs to us, and we're not doing anything to take it back from the king of Syria? So he asked Jehoshaphat, will you go with me and fight against Ramoth-Gilead? Well, Jehoshaphat, the king of Israel, I guess they had sort of a NATO there. I am as you are, my people as your people, my horses as your horses. But Jehoshaphat was a little cautious man. He didn't like to do things. You know, he was a son of David, you know, one of the descendants of David who thought this way. He said, first, seek the counsel of the Lord. So the king of Israel brought together the prophets, about 400 men, and he asked them, shall I go to war against Ramoth-Gilead, or shall I for it refrain? They said, go, for the Lord will give it into the king's hand. The English had a word for people like this. The word was lickspittle. Now, mind you, I'm not saying today's news media are prophets, only that they are playing the same role. They are telling the government what the government wants to hear at this point, which is really odd historically, because basically in the past, the news media have always been in the opposition. Didn't make any difference who was in the White House. The news media were in opposition. And in fact, that is a good thing. That's the way the founding fathers saw all of this. And if you think the news media have been rough in, you know, recent years, you should know what they were like when Abraham Lincoln was president. But never mind. I'm not saying they are prophets, that they're playing the role. Okay. Jehoshaphat, having heard all this stuff, said, isn't there a prophet of Jehovah here that we can inquire of? That in itself is fascinating. What was he seeing out there amongst these prophets? Well, he realized that whatever they weren't prophets of God. So, the king of Israel answered Jehoshaphat, well, there's still one man we can inquire of Jehovah, but I hate him because he never prophesies anything good about me, always bad. He is Micaiah, the son of Imlah. Ah, the king should not say that, Jehoshaphat said. This is almost funny. I'll let you draw your own comparisons with it. Well, the king of Israel called one of his officials and says, bring Micaiah, the son of Israel, of Imlah, at once. So here were the two kings, dressed in their royal robes, the king of Israel and Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, sitting at their thrones on the threshing floor by the entrance of the gate of Samaria, with all the prophets prophesying before them. Here's one of them. Zedekiah, the son of Kenai, had made horns of iron. And he said, this is what the Lord says. With these you will gore the Arameans until they are destroyed. All the other prophets were saying the same thing. Attack Ramoth-Gilead and be victorious, for the Lord will give it into the king's hand. Just incredible. You know, it was a show. These people were putting on a show for these two kings. They were all standing there and just enjoying. See what he's done there? Really funny. The messenger who had gone to summon Micaiah apparently liked him. And he said, look, as one man, the other prophets are predicting success for the king. Now let your word agree with theirs and speak favorably. The messenger wanted to keep him out of trouble. But Micaiah said, as surely as the Lord lives, I can tell him only what the Lord tells me. Now when he arrived, the king asked him, Micaiah, shall we go to war against Ramoth-Gilead or shall I refrain? And what happens here, what follows, is a prime example of sarcasm. And I suppose Micaiah's manner revealed it very clearly. Ahab saw it clearly enough. Attack and be victorious, he said, for the Lord will give it into the king's hand. And the king said, how many times must I make you swear to tell me nothing but the truth in the name of the Lord? That is incredible. He knew. He understood. He was aware. But he couldn't seem to find a way to respond to it. His problem was, here's all these other prophets telling me the other thing. I know that this is a man of God. I know that what he says is more often right than wrong. But if I listen to him and reject all these others, where will I be? It's a really staggering comparison to make here, even all the way right into the modern world. There'll be some differences, of course. But then he said, after he said, I've told you, don't tell me anything but the truth. And Micaiah answered and said, I saw all Israel scattered on the hills like sheep without a shepherd. And the Lord said, these people have no master. Let each one of them go home in peace. Then the king of Israel said to Jehoshaphat, didn't I tell you that he never prophesies anything good about me, but only bad? Now what follows is fascinating and the topic of many, many questions and endless Bible discussions. Micaiah continued, okay, hear the word of the Lord. I saw the Lord sitting on his throne with all the host of heaven standing around him on his right hand and on his left. And the Lord said, who will entice Ahab into attacking Ramoth-Gilead and going to his death there? Well, one suggested this, another suggested that. Finally, a spirit came forward and stood before the Lord and said, I'll do it. I'll entice him. How? Said the Lord. I will go out and be a lying spirit in the mouth of all his prophets. And God said, that'll work. You will succeed in enticing him. Go and do it. So, Micaiah concluded, the Lord has put a lying spirit in the mouth of all these prophets of yours, because the Lord has decreed disaster for you. What on earth happened here? People puzzle over this. What? God sent a lying spirit? That doesn't sound like God. Micaiah presents this as a vision or a dream, not necessarily as fact. It may have happened just this way in heaven. On the other hand, it may be a parable and not necessarily what happened. It may be just the way of explaining to Ahab so he will understand in his stupid terms what happened. So anyway, Ahab was free to listen and repent or to do what he was determined to do from the start. That's important. How do I know that? Because of the prime directive. Because of the guiding principle through all this. Okay, Zedekiah, the son of Kenaniah, went up and slapped Micaiah in the face. Which way did the Spirit of the Lord go from me to speak to you? And Micaiah replied, you'll find out on the day you go to hide in an inner room. Have you ever noticed how the media slap people around who don't follow the pattern? And how they almost have a gang mentality, the way they go about it? It's really uncanny, eerie at times, the way they go like a stampeding herd in this direction, and then they go stampeding back in another direction, just like a bunch of false prophets. Now, God could have stopped all this. Why didn't he? Well, because Zedekiah was free to slap Micaiah, and Micaiah was free to be slapped. That's just the way it is in this world. The king of Israel ordered, take Micaiah, send him back to Ammon, the ruler of the city, to Joash, the king's son, and say, this is what the king says. Put this fellow in prison. Give him nothing but bread and water until I return safely. And Micaiah declared, if you ever return safely, the Lord has not spoken through me. Mark my words, all you people. I don't know what happened to Micaiah, but he was one courageous man. But you know, there comes a place where you got to. You have to be. You have to stand up. Because if these people are to be free to do God's will or not do God's will, they got to be told what it is, right? So, as far as I can know, he stayed in prison on bread and water until he was dead. It took a lot of backbone to do that. As it seems to happen in society, what happens in society out here like this is sometimes reflected in the church. I said we are at a pivotal point where God has scattered the power of a holy people. You know, our what we thought was a church that was all organized under authority and rule, all that has been scattered to the four winds and left in rags and pieces. There may be a core somewhere of what was there, but it wouldn't even be recognizable to us any longer. What happened to that church is so contrary to any expectation, counterintuitive, that you just have to see the hand of God in what happened there. I do. I mean, I don't have any question about it. I told somebody once upon a time back when the Worldwide Church of God was basically apostatizing. I said, no, I don't think those guys are crooks, because he'd said he thought they were. I said, no. Crooks would simply sit there and keep raking in the money, flying around on the jet, enjoying life, eating in the best restaurants, using the credit cards, you know, feathering their nest. They're not crooks. Fools, maybe, but not crooks. Because they actually, the action they were taking, any sound-minded man would know, was going to take all that away from them. It could not hold together. Because they were going contrary to some of the most fundamental principles. And what was also interesting about this is, they did what they did under the old prism, the old paradigm. With centralized, top-down authority, they tried to change that church and tore it to ribbons. Some of us would like to rebuild, not only nationally, but in our own country. We'd kind of like to see the church rebuilt as well. But I want you to think for a moment about what our fathers in this land had to deal with. You may remember the stories that the ongoing battle between the governors in this country and the King of England and the English Parliament, and the things that they were trying to do. They were beginning to lay more and more taxes on us over here. We had no say whatsoever. We walked down to, you know, to buy some tea and bang, there's a tax on it. Nobody in this country had anything to say about it. Well, it came to pass As everybody by now knows, one night a bunch of them dressed up like Indians and went down to the wharf and unloaded some British ships into the harbor. They call it the Boston Tea Party because they threw all that tea in the water. We're not going to drink it. And that was where some of this stuff began to get started. By the way, don't call people today who are resisting teabaggers. That's an insulting expression. I won't even try to tell you what it means. They finally declared their independence and the British came to fight. The turning point in all the American Revolution came about in 1776, later in the year. And it's a fascinating story. Washington had at one time 30,000 men in his army. But expiring enlistments, desertions, had brought him down to 2,500 men left. One-third of them had no boots. They had to wrap their feet in burlap to be able to make it in these winter conditions that they found themselves in. It was Christmas Day, 1776, December 25th, last night, that Washington gathered his men together, got their boats. He'd made preparations for all of this, got all of his boats together, and crossed the Delaware in the middle of the night. His 2,500 men and he, some of them, as I said, leaving blood in their footsteps and their burlap bags around their feet, going down to Trenton, where the Hessians, a trained army of professional soldiers, numbering nearly 1,000, were encamped. They went down there in the middle of the night, 2,500 men. They took 1,000 prisoners. They took their muskets. They took their powder. They took their artillery. It was a great victory. Only a handful of people actually lost their lives on that night. The Hessians were professional soldiers enough to realize when they were beaten, so they surrendered, and Washington won. A few weeks later, Washington had 15,000 men who had joined his army because people began to see what was going to come down. It's fascinating how parallels occur, as I said, between society at large and the church in particular. And I wonder how far you will be willing to walk with no boots, bleeding, burlap-wrapped feet, because something like that may be what it takes to win, may be what it takes to preserve our freedom and to pull ourselves together so we can do the things that God has put us here to do. Christianity at large is basically what we would call Laodicean, apathetic, lukewarm, pursuing their own interests. Like a lot of Washington's troops, they thought, it's warm at home. What am I doing camped out here? They threw their stuff over their shoulder and went marching off into the night to go home, to the fire, to their farm, to their wives, to their kids. And I'm afraid that kind of mentality is out there right now among Christian people in this country. It's not among Christian people in Sudan. It's not above Christian people in many parts of Africa where their lives are at stake every day because they're Christians, but it is here. And one wonders if there is somewhere a Gideon who will leave his farm and join the battle. Because it's kind of funny. It's almost as though as Gideon went to battle, God said, too many people, I can't win with this group. Send them home. Worked a little different for Washington, but its result, the outcome was the same. They went down to the river. Gideon's men went down, the ones that lapped like a dog, and then it has others of them, they drank with their hand, holding the water up to their face. He made this as the distinction, sent the larger number home. Was it 300 people that Gideon had left? 300. And he defeated a huge army camped out before him. Now, it's really interesting, you know, my question is there a Gideon out there somewhere in the country? Is there a Gideon in the church? Is there a Gideon among Christianity at large who will actually do this? One wonders if a core army can be assembled so committed they will fight without boots and cross a frozen river in the middle of the night if they had to, that they would fight to win. I don't know. There is one thing I do know. I know the organizing principle, and I know the prime directive that arises from it. You shall not abridge the freedom of God's people. And freedom is the organizing principle.